The popular image of the classic fighting man from the Middle Ages is that of the mounted knight in armor, bearing lance and shield, challenging his chivalric foes to feat of arms and tournament joust. His Renaissance descendant is seen as a swashbuckling cavalier, flourishing his slender, thrusting blade in a private duel of honor. But these romanticized notions, often perpetuated by popular culture, are mere shadows of the historical European man-at-arms. The uninformed modern myths of untutored knights in heavy armor, clumsily whacking weighty swords, and of swashbuckling rogues crudely slashing their primitive rapiers are shattered by the true history. Despite decades of popular misconception and persistent misportrayal, the historical evidence reveals an unequivocal portrait of these diverse fighting men as highly trained warriors, expertly employing sophisticated methods of systematic close combat skills. The fighting man of these times readily mastered indigenous traditions of Renaissance martial arts. While the term martial arts today is typically synonymous with Asian fighting arts, for centuries, highly sophisticated Western European martial arts existed. Their effectiveness and formidability, documented in accounts and chronicles, was combat proven from Scandinavia to the Mediterranean, from Spain to Russia, and from the Near East to the New World. It is from the Latin that we actually derive the English term martial arts. From the arts of Mars, the Roman god of war. The term martial art was itself used in regard to fighting skills as early as the 1550s to refer specifically to the art of defense, knightly prowess in arms, or the noble science called fencing. Fencing meant far more than just swordplay. The knightly classes of the early Middle Ages christened these skills as the chivalric arts and the art of chivalry. Renaissance writers described warrior training as the doctrina armorum, the disciplina gladiatorial, and the art militari. The essential function of such instruction was to enable a fighting man to better deal with the chaos of personal combat by preparing himself with an understanding of what was possible. From about the 12th century, professional instruction in fencing existed across Western Europe. By the 14th century, many of these instructors in arms, or masters of defense, became highly regarded international experts. They systematized and taught their fighting methods, then recorded their craft in vast and, until now, relatively unknown technical literature. Over time, they uniquely produced hundreds of detailed, often well-illustrated training manuals and study guides that still survive. But these experts in close combat were no mere fencers. Theirs were fighting systems suited to a wide range of threats and conditions over several centuries. The teachings of these masters of defense involved understanding and applying key principles and concepts, crucial physical and mental components inherent to all hand-to-hand combat. The weapons of dagger, staff, and axe were studied as vigorously as pole weapons, shields, and especially all manner of swords. Grappling and unarmed wrestling techniques were also vital elements of their methods. These still little-known works reveal their craft of fighting to be one of sophisticated and systematic skills that stressed fighting effectively. When studied from within their own cultural context, these surviving works present a portrait of highly developed indigenous European martial arts. They portray integrated self-defense methods focused largely on armored and unarmored fighting on foot or mounted, using a variety of weapons and empty-handed techniques. The indisputable picture of Renaissance close combat presented by these sources is frequently one of expert warriors expertly employing agile, well-balanced, ingeniously designed, and well-proven weapons with vicious efficiency. Theirs were not slow, ponderous, or ungainly tools. Today, dozens of these obscure handwritten manuscripts and printed books provide an unequaled resource for modern students of historical fencing. As both practical skill and scientific art, the methods of close combat from these eras had to be athletic, fierce, and swift. Its deadly tools were formidable, sophisticated, robust, uniformly agile, and highly effective implements. To understand the development of these fighting arts, we need only examine the medieval legacy of war, violence, and duels.